Batman is held to a very different standard to other superheroes. There has always been a trend towards making Batman more realistic than other superheroes. There's this sense that he's darker, more real than the likes of Superman or Captain America. His villains are more serious and his world is grittier. This impulse has been pushed so much that the very idea of Batman doesn't seem silly to us anymore, even though if we take a step back and look at him, he's a dude who dresses up like a bat to punch people. That is the essential contradiction of Batman. He's a ridiculous idea, not realistic at all, but he's always been treated like that's not the case. And walking that tightrope is what every great Batman story has to do. I have a horrible confession to make. I'm really more of a Marvel fan. It's not that I dislike DC, I've just never formed the same attachment to that set of characters that I have the Marvel ones. It's probably mostly because the MCU is great and the DC movies are a disconnected mess, but I think it's more than that. Most of the DC heroes are older, and they feel older. They're more basic in their construction. I mean, you don't get more basic than Superman. The exception to this for me has always been Batman, which is weird because I'm really not the dark and brooding type. Yes, Batman has had his goofy phase, but modern Batman has always been taken way more seriously than his fellow superheroes. I think it's because among superheroes, Batman is one of the most human. Yes, there are other superheroes that don't have powers, like Iron Man, but Iron Man is loud and dramatic. Batman's always been more subtle than that, and I think that's why he translates so well to video games. Superheroes have dominated the cinema for the past decade, but they haven't had nearly as strong effect on the world of video games, and I think that's because superheroes are much harder to translate to video games than you might think. The essential problem is that most superheroes are too powerful to convert to a video game format, especially in the early days of game design when technology was a serious limitation. Flight, for example, is a very common superpower, but extremely hard to translate into a video game in a way that looks and feels even halfway decent, especially back in the day. The destructive power of Superman and other heroes that look great in a movie is just prohibitively hard to do with the limitations of a video game. Attempts are being made again in recent years, and to great success, but for almost a decade there was only Batman. That's not to say there weren't other attempts at superhero games in this era, there was, but none of them had the staying power and cultural influence of the Batman Arkham series. Back in 2008, superhero games were the domain of cheap movie tie-in games and button-mash fighters. The idea of a big-budget superhero game with no movie tie-in was basically unheard of. So, how did Arkham Asylum break the mold? How did it single-handedly save superhero games and bring them out of mediocrity? Well, it was easy, by being one of the best-designed games ever made! Arkham Asylum has a story, and we'll talk about it, but the story of Arkham Asylum has little to do with its success or the reasons it sparked a decade-long franchise. To briefly summarise, the Joker, Batman's oldest and most hated rival, takes over Arkham Asylum, a hospital/prison for the criminally insane, and a series of deadly hijinks follows. It's a perfectly passable Batman story, but the script is not the star of Arkham Asylum. The star is the gameplay and the atmosphere. It's kind of a review cliché to say these days, but the game makes you feel like Batman and like a part of his weird gothic world. Instead of taking Batman and slotting him into an existing genre like fighting game or side-scroller, the game takes the core aspects of Batman and builds the genre around him. Gameplay can be split into three distinct phases. Fistfights, a representation of Batman's master martial arts skills, Predator mode, a representation of Batman's mastery of both stealth and of fear, and Exploration and Investigation, a representation of Batman's world's greatest detective title. These three phases will be cycled throughout the game and beyond. Every game in the series uses these three phases as their core gameplay loop, with the exception of Arkham Knight, which adds an extra one. What's crazy in returning back to the start here in Asylum isn't how different the gameplay is, but how similar it is. That's not a sign of the series being creatively bankrupt. Just the age-old rule that if it ain't broke, don't fix it, because boy did they absolutely nail it on the first go-around. Every game after this one polishes and refines these systems, with Arkham Knight having the best overall. But the difference between the two games really isn't that much. The melee combat is probably the standout. It's a brawler system that's all about building up combos foes and avoiding being hit, generally pitting you against a large group of foes that you bounce between rapid fast. It's much less about difficulty and much more about flow. The game's not ridiculously easy, but it's not massively hard either. The controls are very intuitive and very fun even after several hours of repetition, helped in particular by the sound design. Every punch and kick lands with a meaty thud and the violent cracking of bones when you knock someone out cold. As close as I think you can get to the wha-bam, kapow noises of a comic book panel. It requires more thinking as you get further into the game, and variations of enemies start showing up. Knife guys have to be stunned before they can be hit, where stun baton guys can only be struck from behind, and then eventually the big monster men need to be carefully dealt with in their own ways while managing the rest of the foes. It's fantastic, exactly how Batman should fight. Fast and fluid, but also tactically and carefully considered. Within this combat system, you think like Batman does, and you fight as he does too. When you get into the high combos and time starts to slow down, you just feel like an absolute badass. Predator mode, on the other hand, is an entirely different kind of thrill. Sometimes you'll enter a room with 5 to 6 guys patrolling with machine guns. Batman is a mortal man, so he can't soak up that many bullets. Instead, you'll have to lurk in the shadows, finding discreet and painful ways to incapacitate the guards without ever being seen, watching in glee as they get more and more terrified as you pick them off one by one. These maps are essentially playgrounds that reward ingenuity. Sure, you can just sneak up behind everyone and choke them out, or you could use explosive gel to blow up the wall behind them, or maybe use the bat claw to pull them off a railing, or use the gargoyles around the walls to tie them up helplessly for all their friends to see, and maybe use a batarang to drop that friend on top of another one that comes running to help. Batman has a tool for every job, and while most of them are primarily for exploration, they all have their utility in Predator mode as well. Exploration is the final chunk of gameplay, and it's how you bridge the gaps between the fighting and the sneaking. However, that's not to say it's boring. Far from it, Arkham Asylum is a strange and mysterious place with secrets lurking around every corner, just waiting for the great detective to sniff them out. The Arkham games are kind of infamous for the Riddler's machinations, and particularly Riddler trophies, these little green glowing question marks. Later games certainly make them a chore, but here in the first game and the more condensed map, they're more of a thing to hunt between story moments. Like the actual riddles the Riddler sends you, where you have to find the thing in the environment that the riddle is referencing, these green question marks are themselves a sort of navigational riddle. I can see you, but how do I get to you? The game has light Metroidvania elements where gadgets you acquire later will help you solve the riddles you saw earlier but couldn't quite figure out, giving you a good reason to go back and explore again. Plus, the Riddler is just so smug about his challenges that it's worth doing just to show him who's boss.
Can you hear that, detective? It's the sound of me clapping at your success. Oh, you can't? That's because an idiot would have found that trophy.
Besides, when a game looks as good as this, you really don't mind seeing it again. Arkham Asylum is just a fantastic looking game, even 15 years later. The footage you're seeing now is from the 2016 remaster, granted, but most of what that did was updating textures and particle effects. It's really the art direction and the design that steals the show. It's not realistic, and that's not really what the game's even going for. Where you might expect the visual influence of a modern Batman game to be the Christopher Nolan films that were coming out at the time, instead the game's biggest artistic influence is clearly the 90s animated series, especially the design of Batman himself. Like the cartoon, he's been designed from the silhouette outward. He doesn't have realistic proportions, he has massive broad shoulders and tree trunk arms, but that's how Batman is supposed to look, and that sort of cartoony realism has been applied to every character and the design of the asylum itself. The island is not realistic in any way, it's a hyper-gothic labyrinth where everything is pushed to the extreme. It's split into 5 separate buildings, with an explorable outside area connecting them and an underground level below, and while each has its own distinct style and can clearly be told apart, they're all very cohesive and capture the tone of the game perfectly. Arkham Asylum may be under the control of a madman now, but the rot and corruption set in here long before the Joker took over. From the ancient crumbling Victorian hospital to the maximum security wing where men crazed like animals are locked in cages with an electric floor, Arkham Asylum seems like a place more likely to drive a person mad than to cure them. A darkness lurks in the walls, and that's exactly the point. Even the sewer level, usually a safe bet for worst level in a game, is no ordinary sewer. It's a maze of pipes and tunnels and ancient medieval underground aqueducts that really don't make any sense, but they don't have to. This is a cartoony world with cartoony architectural features, and despite being out of place, it feels like a natural and normal part of the asylum. The features are just as crazy as the residents. The atmosphere is claustrophobic, and even though the architecture is way bigger than necessary, you're a mouse caught in a maze, forced to play along with the Joker's games. Except, not quite, because you're no ordinary mouse. You're Batman. This is the amazing skill this game has in building its atmosphere. In many ways, it could be a horror game. It's got monsters and madness and an old, possibly haunted insane asylum. If you were some defenseless journalist, you'd be rightly terrified. But with Batman as an anchor, you never feel truly defenseless. These aren't monsters to run from, they're monsters to sucker punch. Batman isn't truly trapped on the island, he proves that when he calls in his jet plane to drop off a gadget. Like you, he's here because he wants to be. He's here to stop the Joker, and none of this spooky nonsense is gonna get in his way. The game is very much not an origin story. This is a Batman well into his career. So far, in fact, that Oracle is a major part of the game, which means not only has Batgirl been a thing and assumedly all the Robins, but Batgirl has already been injured and stuck in a wheelchair. The game reinforces that well-established Batman feeling with a genius bit of casting, getting the voices of Kevin Conroy, Mark Hamill, and Arlene Sorkin to reprise their roles from the Batman animated series as Batman, Joker, and Harley Quinn, respectively. It adds a layer of authenticity to the whole thing. This is a Batman who's been doing this for a long while, since at least 1992, in fact. Batman and Joker's relationship feels so old and well-established because it genuinely is. This isn't the first time we've seen them go head-to-head. Also, all three of them are just absolutely fantastic casting and always have been. So, with all that groundwork laid out, an amazing and atmospheric setting, veteran voice actors returning to their iconic roles, the story of this game is probably amazing, right? Absolutely not. This game is dumber than a bag of erasers. The Joker has a magic goo that turns men into big hulking monsters, and Batman has to stop him from poisoning the water supply and turning everyone in the city into big rage monsters. It's not that a magic goo that turns people into monsters is inherently dumb, it's just so cliche. Trust me, before the sky beam, there was the evil goo. The story has its redeeming elements, mostly to do with the voice performances and the dialogue, but the overarching plot of the game leaves a lot to be desired. It's a shame, too, because the game starts so strongly. The game begins with a long walk, escorting the Joker back to his cell. He's tied up, surrounded by armed guards, and yet something seems off. The further you walk, the deeper you go, the more and more trapped and claustrophobic you begin to feel. When this trap is finally sprung, you're in way too deep for a quick escape. It's these parts of the story that really work, it's just that between the really cool and interesting bits, they feel the need to do some video gamey nonsense. Scarecrow is another great example. At several points in the game, you're secretly exposed to Scarecrow's fear toxin, which makes Batman start to hallucinate his darkest fears. In fact, when I first played this game as a wee child, the first Scarecrow scene, which happens to take place in a morgue, actually scared me off the game for a good long time before I mustered up the courage to power through. There's all these weird visuals. He sees Commissioner Gordon being dragged like a slasher flick, locusts start climbing up the walls, the walls start to rot away, and then you get to the actual morgue itself. In one body bag, his dad, in another, his mum, and in the final bag, Scarecrow himself. It's a really cool, genuinely uncomfortable sequence that leverages the strengths of the video game medium. But that's only phase one. Phase two is this. It kinda dissolves a lot of the tension when it turns into one of those avoid the spotlight stealth challenges on a bunch of floating platforms. Another prime example of the game leaning on old video game cliches when it could and provably can be doing something more interesting. The game can be really clever, like the third of the Scarecrow sequences where he breaks the fourth wall to enact one of your fears when he crashes the game, resetting it with a flip of the intro where you control Joker as Batman is taken inside. It even gives you a fake tutorial tip when you get shot shot in the head and die. Then you emerge from your own grave and oh, you're back to the spotlight platforming again. Yay! There's a great tense scene with Killer Croc in his lair where you have to walk slowly to avoid giving away your location and act fast when he springs up for an ambush. But the reason you're down there is to collect the magic anti-monster goo, which happens to grow on the same island as the evil monster goo. The game in its open world has an amazing sense of escalation. In the beginning, there's still real guards out and about, but they're quickly replaced with Joker's goons. Then Joker unleashes the lunatics onto the island to just charge at you like crazed animals. Then when Poison Ivy gets some of the evil magic goo, the place starts to become overtaken by vines and weird poison pods, culminating in a pretty good boss fight with Ivy herself. The madness and the danger of the island is even represented on Batman, as his costume gets more and more tattered as the game progresses, each encounter and challenge leaving its mark. But then the last fight of the game is when Joker himself takes the magic monster goo and turns into a big monster for one of the most anticlimactic boss fights in video game history. He just aimlessly swings his big claws at you for a few minutes, jumps onto the ledge so you can fight some goons, and then turns around to pose for the news helicopter so you can pull him off the ledge where he gets those big useless claws stuck in the floorboards, leaving you free to punch him repeatedly in the face. You repeat this exact pattern 3 times and then the game is over. It's a terrible fight and it's thematically meaningless. The Joker has never been a big monster type villain who gets into monster duels. He's more psychological than that. Even in this game, it reeks of feeling like in order to be a satisfying finale to a video game, there has to be a big boss fight at the end, and Joker's who we've got, so turn him into a big monster, I guess. And we're not even going to question why it makes the Joker twice as big and he's still able to talk and quip and isn't a snarling, raging monster, because Batman also got infected with the goo and he shrugged it off by trying really hard. After the fight, the game ends with the thinnest of resolutions. Everyone is back in their cells, Commissioner Gordon tells Batman to get some rest, but duty calls, and Batman sets off to the next adventure, completely unfazed and unchanged by the game's events. It's an amazing setup for a story that's severely handicapped by the worst impulses of game writing and the tropes of video game storytelling. With one saving grace, despite all of its silliness, this is a story that understands Batman on a fundamental level. One of the benefits of writing a Batman story is assumed knowledge. Batman is so iconic that you can assume that any reader, watcher, or player has a baseline understanding of the character, and probably at least some of the villains as well. I've mentioned several of his most iconic villains in this video without getting into any detail about them, and I'm willing to bet, especially based on my audience analytics, that I don't have to. You know who the Joker is, you know who the Riddler is, you know who Poison Ivy is, and you don't need me to explain them to you even if you've never played the game before. By jumping right in with a pre-established Batman, the game can explore all of those dynamics without any worry of having to introduce them. People can just show up in this game, and it's a fairly safe bet that you'll know who it is and get what's going on. We can skip the whole part where Bane explains his origins and how he became addicted to a super steroid drug of a slightly different magic goo variety, and just jump straight into the boss fight. It's a trick the game pulls several times. Serious and important Batman villains can just appear in the game without any real foreshadowing or fanfare, and it's fine. If anything, it makes the world feel more real and more lived in. Joker may be the big threat today, but on previous nights it was Poison Ivy or Killer Croc or Clayface, and they were all sent here to the asylum by Batman's handiwork. One of Batman's most defining characteristics, and I would argue his most important trait, is that Batman does not kill. Most superheroes prefer to avoid killing if they can help it, but none of them take it as seriously as Batman does. And that's a rule that the entire Arkham series would make a part of its identity as well. It's actually exceptionally rare to see a game of this budget where you don't kill anyone. More than that, you make an active attempt to preserve life as much as you possibly can. There's a scene early on in the game that shows exactly how well this game understands Batman. During his initial escape, the Joker floods a room with his famous laughing gas, killing everyone in the room except a few people who were able to climb up high enough, 2 guards and a prisoner. Batman helps the 2 guards up, but he helps the prisoner as well, before slamming his face into the deck and knocking him unconscious. There are no loopholes here. Batman will save criminals and killers from death, even if they don't deserve it, because despite his rough exterior and painful methods, He is a good man, trying to do the right thing in a harsh and difficult world. An interesting aspect of this game is that Batman genuinely believes in redemption. He believes that any of these criminals can be set on a better path. Despite all of their horrible crimes, he treats them like people and tries to reason with them. And it's an aspect of his character that by this stage in his career, the Joker is actively exploiting.
Seeing as how I'm feeling generous, I'll give you this one for free. Knock me off!
I dare you.
End this! Pull the plug! Stop me once and for all! Oh, you're getting too predictable, Bats!
While some people, and unfortunately some people who write Batman stories, might see this as illogical and somehow cowardly, his extreme moral code is what makes Batman so human. Yes, logically it would make sense to just shoot Joker and be done with it, but what would that make Batman? A murderer. Someone who sinks to the level of those he detests. And besides, he believes that people can change, and even people as cruel and twisted as the Joker should be given that chance. A core belief in the goodness of humanity is what defines Batman, way more than his capes or his gadgets. That's why the Joker is such a great rival to him. He's someone who pushes Batman to the breaking point, a total nihilist who kills without remorse and has no desire or interest in redemption. Even in a silly story where he becomes a big monster, the point of the Joker still comes through. He wants Batman to break his rule. He wants him to get so mad that he'll snap and kill him. He even tries to force it with his magic goo, but it doesn't work, and as long as Batman stays true to himself and his beliefs, it never will. It's not an amazing or deep moral or anything like that, but at the end of the day, it's a feel-good one. It's been a night of chaos, but it didn't break Batman. He still believes in the goodness of humanity, and he's not the only one. For all the sinister vibes of the asylum, at least some of the doctors are genuinely trying to help these people. One of the collectibles in the game is interview tapes with the various supercriminals you face. For all the sinister vibes of the asylum, at least some of the doctors are genuinely trying to help these people. They've just been set up to fail. The final collectible in the game are hidden messages from someone called the Spirit of Arkham, and they tell a fascinating tale of what's going on behind the scenes and how the asylum came to be as it is now. The man who created the asylum, Amadeus Arkham, initially created the place for similar reasons to Batman himself. His family was murdered. But when he confronted the killer, he saw a man who needed his help, not a monster, and so he formed the asylum as a genuine attempt to help the criminally insane. Unfortunately, Amadeus himself was not a stable man, and by the time of writing these messages scrawled in strange runes around the asylum, his condition has clearly degraded. You can even find the cell that the man himself would eventually end up in. The messages don't stop there though, they keep going, and they're clearly talking about the modern prisoners, references to the Joker and Killer Croc and Poison Ivy. Someone else is writing the messages now, someone clearly in a position of power, and someone with a deep loathing for the people that the asylum is supposed to be helping.
I took a walk around my island. I passed by the penitentiary and felt nauseous at the thought of the filth it contained. I looked out over the Gotham Bay. And in the distance, I saw lights. No doubt boats bringing more filthy degenerates to my city. I swore again to protect her from this darkness.
By the end of the messages, it's clear that that person is Quincy Sharp, the current warden of the asylum and the man running for mayor of Gotham City. The reason the asylum seems set up to fail, seems set up to torture and hurt the inmates instead of helping them, is because that's exactly what it is. The system has been designed not to help these people, but to hurt them, to break and torture them in the name of righteous vengeance. There's something to be said there about the prison industrial complex and how we as a society view the idea of prisons, but this game has no interest in exploring that further than these hidden messages. We'll save that one for the sequel. And unfortunately, because this is ultimately a side activity, Batman doesn't really comment on or consider the fact that the place he's been sending all these people after he defeats isn't actually doing anything to help them, and is in fact just a place where they get tortured and driven further towards insanity. Which is a shame, because I'm sure he'd have some interesting thoughts on that. Instead, it's left open-ended. The warden escapes before you get a chance to confront him, and that's likely the final story beat for most people playing the game, at least the ones who bother to go back and find all the collectibles. Arkham Asylum wasn't designed with a sequel in mind, but it leaves enough open questions that a sequel can build off of, and build off of them it did, but we'll get to that some other time. Arkham Asylum is a fantastic game and a mediocre story, but its lasting legacy doesn't end there. Instead, it's remembered as the foothold of a franchise. Not the best game in the series, but the block that all the other games would be built upon. And beyond, this game would go on to influence superhero games across the board. I have my issues with it, but I respect it. It's a game worthy of the legacy it's created. It's just that its sequel would surpass it in every single way that matters. And don't worry, we're gonna do them all. So I hope you'll join me next time for Batman Arkham City. Breaking Batman.
Ready for the next round?
Always.
What?
I'll never let you win. Never.
Thank you very much for watching. If you liked this video, what's going on? Oh my god, it's a Patreon name! Yes, I'd like to end this video with a very special shout out to my first ever name in the credits tier patron, Joe LD. You're an absolute champion, and I could be more thankful for your support. If you would like to join Joe on this list, you can find my Patreon linked in the description below, or you can like the video, subscribe, comment what you think of the game, or maybe watch some more videos. I have a series of Borderlands critiques that may interest you, or if you're still in a superhero mood, maybe this video on the Inhumans tastes your fancy.